Welcome to First Christian Church. So good to see everyone, and I want to welcome back individuals that are in person in worship back in this sacred space, and also those who are joining us online this morning. We've got a beautiful Sunday morning and a really powerful message this morning. You know, this morning is interesting because we call this World Communion Sunday, a Sunday we bring together all the churches of our world to gather around this table where we have communion. So it's so good that we are able to have communion each and every Sunday, which not all churches do, but all churches try to correlate today as a Sunday for communion. So welcome, and welcome to this worldwide church. You know, we are different communities, we're different climates, we're different regions, yet we have one teacher, Christ our Lord, who is living the word that God spoke. We are different races, we're different faces, we're different places, yet we have one Lord, one faith, one baptism. So let us open ourselves up to each other and let us join in worship. And again, welcome to First Christian Church. Let's worship together.
And we will begin our worship with "This Is the Day."
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made, we will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made.
Will you join together as we lead in the call to worship? As we gather around the communion table today,
we remember all the peoples of the world.
A world divided into many nations and tongues.
Yet around this table, we find unity.
We find a common hope and spirit.
We find a God who is the creator of every man and woman, every plant and animal.
We find a common chorus of praise with sisters and brothers around the world.
We find a world family.
We find a church.
We find a new strength.
Let us worship God.
And let us worship God. Our opening hymn today is "How Great Thou Art." We'll do one verse of this. If you're at home, sing along. If you're in the sanctuary here today, the words will be on the screen, and you can take them in as we go along here today.
In our unity prayer. It'll be up here on the screen for you. Dear God, help us to move our compassion to reach out to all in the world. As we celebrate communion worldwide, we remember how big the table is. We see it full of people today stretching around the world. Let us remember our common table in the years to come
and seek to treat all our brothers and sisters as if they were sitting beside us. Since you include and invite everyone to your table, help us, Lord, to do the same with open hearts and open minds. For we pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Let's join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I'm going to ask any children we have at home to come close to the screen now. And we have one with us today in the sanctuary. Maya, I see that you're here today. If you come to the service outside or if you come inside now, please let us know if you're bringing a child with you. We have a special pack that we've made for the kids, and I actually passed them all out this morning, so I don't have one in my hand. But in that pack, I'm going to go ahead and sit down, sorry. In that pack, we have things that go with the children's sermon. We usually have a crossword puzzle, coloring sheet, crayons, pencils, pens, whatever you need. And often there's all those things go right with my story. Today I have something else in the pack for you guys, and but we'll get to that in just a second. In your pack there's a glove, and so Maya, if you want to pull yours out, we're going to use it in just a second. What I have for them is a glove. And what I'm going to talk to you about is gloves. Some of us have seen a lot of different kind of gloves lately. One that you've probably seen a lot of is one of these clear gloves. We see them in all the time. People that work in the food services industry have to wear these, and it protects their hand. When they put it on, then their hand is protected from germs. If you're handling people's food, it keeps you from getting a germ on your hand into their food. These protect your skin. The other thing I use these for is when I'm getting ready to put my turkey in the oven on Thanksgiving, and you put olive oil on it and you rub it all in, I use a glove because then I can peel it off and throw it away and my hands are clean. So this is a very useful glove, right? And I have another glove here. This is a warm glove. I put this on in the winter and I can use it when I'm driving and the steering wheel's not cold, or if I'm just out walking, taking a walk, keeps my hands warm. I can make a snowball with it. My hands don't freeze. It's a great thing, this glove. It's wonderful. It's so useful. Now, I have another glove here. Some of y'all may recognize these. I think the Helping Hand Circle gave me this one time. This glove is a glove used for cleaning. I know it's a fancy one, right? But I can put this one on, and it protects my hands from the cleaners that I use. Some of them are like chemicals, and so it protects my skin. And I can use it for all kinds of things. That's kind of cool. And it's pretty. So, these are all useful gloves. Now, the last one I have, and Maya has one of these in her pack. Some of them are purple and some of them are green. But the purple one, I've got it right here in my hand. This glove is a special glove. It does something really special. This glove is a bath glove, and you can put it on your hand, and you get in the bath, and you put soap all in it, and you rub it on your skin, and it takes off all the dirt. You know, you've been playing in the dirt pile this afternoon, and it takes off the dead skin cells, and it's supposed to feel really good. It feels rough when you just feel it right now, but that's a special glove. But let me ask you this. When this glove is sitting in the kids' pack, and when this glove is sitting under my sink, and when this glove is hanging in my closet, And this glove is still in the box. Are they useful? Are they doing anything? They don't do anything. They just sit there. They can't do anything by themselves. They're just hanging out. But if I take one of these gloves and put it on, then things can happen. I can make things happen. Once my hand is in it, it can do things. It can clean. It can help me get a job done. It protects me. So my hand has to be in the glove for the glove to be useful, correct? So how are you like this glove? Well, if we're just sitting around, sitting at home on the chair, we're not getting anything done. And if we're not listening to God, we're certainly not getting His work done. To get God's work done, we need God in us, just like we need to be in this glove to make it work. So we need to ask God to be living with us, to live with us, to talk to Him often, to pray. What is it you need me to do, God? Because then you'll be useful to Him to get His work done. Pretty cool, huh? So when you go home, those of you at home, if you have a glove, every time you put it on, and Maya can think about this when she puts her glove on, and those that were at the early service had one with a note attached to it, think about that you're like this glove. And while you are the one that makes the glove useful, God is the one that makes you useful. Let's have a prayer together. So if you'll bow your heads and pray with me, please. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For watching over us.
For watching over us.
For leading us.
For leading us.
And taking us places.
And taking us places.
Where we can be useful.
Where we can be useful.
Remind us.
Remind us.
To keep you.
To keep you.
In our lives.
In our lives.
Just like.
Just like.
We have to be in the glove.
Like we have to be in the glove.
To make it useful.
To make it useful.
Amen.
Amen.
Good morning. We have three scripture passages this morning. Our first one is from the book of Matthew, chapter 21, verses 33 through 46. Listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. Then he leased it to its tenants and went to another country. When the harvest time had come, he sent his slaves to the tenants to collect his produce. But the tenants seized his slaves and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent other slaves, more than the first, and they treated them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, "They will respect my son." But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, "This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and get his inheritance." So they seized him, threw him out of the vineyard, and killed him. Now, when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants? They said to him, "He will put those wretches to a miserable death and lease the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the produce at the harvest time." Jesus said to them, "Have you ever read in the scriptures, 'The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it is amazing in our eyes.' Therefore, I will tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that produces the fruits of the kingdom. The one who falls on his stone will be broken to pieces, and it will crush anyone on whom it falls." When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they realized that he was speaking about them. They wanted to arrest him, but they feared the crowds because they regarded him as a prophet. Our second reading is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 5, verse 1 through 7. Let me sing for my beloved, My love song concerning his vineyard. My beloved and his vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it and cleared it of stones and planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it and hewed out a wine vat in it. He expected it to yield grapes, but it yielded wild grapes. And now, inhabitants of Jerusalem and people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I have not done in it? When I expected it to yield grapes, why did it yield wild grapes? And now I will tell you, what I will do to my vineyard, I will remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. I will break down its wall, and it shall be trampled down. I will make it a waste. It shall not be pruned or hoed, and it shall be overgrown with briars and thorns. I will also command the clouds that they will rain no rain upon it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the people of Judah are his pleasant planting. He expected justice, but saw bloodshed, righteousness, but heard a cry. And our third reading is from the book of Psalm, chapter 80, verses 7 through 15. Restore us, O God of hosts. Let your face shine, that he may be saved. You brought a vine out of Egypt. You drove out the nations and planted it. You cleared the ground for it, and it took deep root and filled the land. The mountains were covered with its shade, the mighty cedars with its branches. It sent out its branches to the sea and its roots to the river. Why then have you broken down its walls so that all who pass along the way pluck its fruit? The boar from the forest ravages it, and all that move in the field feed on it. Turn again, O God of hosts. Look down from heaven and see. Have regard for this vine, the stock that your right hand planted. May God bless the reading of his word.
Well, it's the world's longest scripture reading from Erin. She did an excellent job. Probably should have had some water up here for her so she could have nourished herself as she was reading along. You know, sometimes it's important that you look at scripture in a broader span. And so in this case, three stories about vines and vineyards, and those stories span many hundreds of years in the Bible. It's maybe it helps us get a little bit of perspective that there's been a lot of conversation over a lot of years about vines and vineyards. That's because of the people who lived in this region and because of the value they placed on wine, as we know from Christ and World Communion Sunday. Well, we know that when you look at the issue of a vineyard, that there's a timepiece. There is the investment that initially has to happen in planting all the vines, and then there's a long delay. They have to be nurtured, they have to be pruned, they have to sometimes have grass put in them. Then you have to figure out where the fruit's going to go. And apparently there's a whole art form to how you prune a vineyard, which I don't know, but I know that it takes time and it takes investment. And so all three of these stories are stories about situations that happen in vineyards, but really none of these stories has anything to do with vines or vineyards. They really have to do with who we are as a people and our relationship with God. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to mention something about each one of the stories. I'm going to do it kind of in reverse order. I'm going to start with the psalm that we have. And the psalm story talks about the fact that there was this beautiful graft of a vine that was placed into the ground. It was carried carefully over land and put in an ideal fertile spot. And of course, there's this analogy of this vine being moved and then planted, and then this vine is taken and nurtured. And this is, of course, a perfect analogy in Scripture to what happened with the Israelite people. They are taken out of Egypt. They are moved through a desolate place and into this promised land, into this fertile valley, into a place where they could grow and they could prosper and they could begin to bear fruit. So initially, it's a story about a success story. But what we find in history is that when the psalmist is writing this, the Israelite people have come upon ruin. And when you are in a nation, or even in your own personal life, when things are going along, maybe the way you had anticipated or hoped, but then something happens, something derails the way that you had expected things to go, and if you are a person of faith, which we are, then you turn to God. And in that conversation with God, you're going to either say to God, thank you, or you're going to say to God, why did these things go wrong? And so what we see in the psalmist is there's this initial conversation with God, and the conversation is what we might call the blame game. We say, well, God, you're awesome, and you're almighty, and you could do whatever you want to do. So why, Lord, did you bring this beautiful vineyard into this fertile valley only to have the vineyard trampled by wild beasts and destroyed? And you would say that in your own personal life. God, you've done so much, and yet here I find myself in ruin. What happened? Why did you do this? And so it is the pejorative wagging your finger at God. And we all know that sometimes we find ourselves in that situation where we're just saying, God, why? And God, you're not fair. And God, I'm angry at you. And God, I'm frustrated with you. You've done this. You prepared this soil. And yet, here it is being destroyed. So the psalmist is really what we would call lament. It is a complaining to God, okay? And sometimes, I guess in our modern context, we could say either number one, that's useless, don't complain to God. Or number two, don't complain to God because God is awesome and God's almighty and you shouldn't play with fire. You might find yourself getting burned. But one of the awesome and beautiful things about our scripture is that it contains a lot of writings where people are complaining to God. And one of the things that we try and remind ourselves is that God has got big enough shoulders to hear some of your complaining. At least you're in conversation with God. The second vineyard story comes from the prophet Isaiah. And this story takes a slightly different turn from the psalmist's analogy. In this analogy, Isaiah says, well, the vineyard was set up and everything was done properly. The vines were tended the way they were supposed to be. There was a really good soil. Everything was really moving exactly the way it should have been. The problem is when the grapes were harvested, what happened with these grapes is that the translation that Aaron read says the grapes were wild, but the way we could think of that is you could say the grapes were sour. Now, sometimes I'll encourage my kids to eat fruit, and I'll be like, you should eat fruit. It's really good for you. And my daughters will be, especially maybe you could think of Kira with strawberries. She likes strawberries. So I'll say, well, here's some strawberries. Have some strawberries. But she won't want to eat strawberries, even though she likes strawberries, because she'll have this anxiety that one of the strawberries might be sour. Have you ever had that problem with kids? They don't want to eat fruit because they're not exactly sure that the fruit is going to taste exactly the way the previous piece of fruit tasted. Which, from an adult perspective, we say, well, that's a good thing. That's fine. That's fruit. It's not all exactly congruent, exactly the same fruit. It has different, you know, textures, nuances. And so you should still eat a strawberry. If you like strawberries, go for it. It's worth the risk. Well, in this case, it wasn't worth the risk because there's this vineyard. The grapes are sour, and so they can't be used. And so Isaiah, as the prophet, says, it doesn't make any sense. If you planted the vineyard, if you nurtured the plants, if you did everything exactly the way you were supposed to do, then why would you then have sour grapes? And, of course, this is an analogy of the way that Israel was given so much from God, given so many blessings, given so many opportunities, And yet when God comes to Israel and says, I need you to be my people, the Israelites have turned sour. Why have you turned sour? You've been given so much opportunity. And yet we see the same thing happening to us as Christians. We've been given so much. We've been nurtured by God. And yet we find ourselves sour, find ourselves unable to yield a good fruit. So two Old Testament stories about vines and vineyards, and then Jesus with this beautiful, famous story from the New Testament about a tenant farmer, about a owner who decides to set up a vineyard. And so the owner then leases this land to the workers. And the workers have been out there and they have created this beautiful vineyard, and they have appreciated the fact that they've done all this work and they've allowed it to go to their heads. When the owner goes to the workers, there's an unspoken contract. I am the owner, I own this land, and I'm going to pay you to bring a harvest from this land. But the workers violate this contract. One of the ways that I imagine this in a more simplified form is from a song that we learn at church camp called Sanctuary. And it goes like this. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving. I'll be a living sanctuary for you. And then a camp, around the campfire, it always ends. And then the youth always look at Aaron and I, and we're like, no, we always repeat that song. And they're like, because you don't get it the first time. First time, the youth are too rambunctious. They're just like, oh, we're singing, okay, it's campfire, ah. You have to sing it the second time to really think about it. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary. Well, ironically, here we are on this beautiful Sunday morning, back in this beautiful place we call our sanctuary, a place of worship. Lord, prepare me to be a place that has an open door where you can come inside and be welcomed. Prepare me to be a place that is going to be tried and true. Allow me, Lord, to be manipulated and molded by your ways. Allow me, Lord, to be a mechanism for your grace in this world. Lord, help me to be a safe place, a sanctuary. Beautiful prayer, beautiful song, simple song. And even the youth at some point can finally figure that out. Lord, help me. Well, you know, it's interesting. I've been singing that song for all the years I've been going to camp. And yet still, I'm not always a sanctuary. And I'm not always willing to open up the door of my heart to let people in. I'm not always a mechanism for God's grace. So many years, so many campfires, so many songs, and yet still a shortcoming. And I think that Jesus is speaking to that today when he talks about this story of these workers. They've worked in this field. They've planted these vines. They've nurtured these vines. They have helped to construct this watchtower. The owner of the land has journeyed away. And so in their minds, it's now become theirs. And you know, so often we do that with our lives. We start to take possession of the vineyard, which is us. We start to say, I am the owner of this body. I'm the one who determines what I want to do with my day today. I'm the one who determines what I want to do with my financial assets. I'm the one that decides what this family's going to do. I'm the one that sets the rules around here. And we call that individualism. And it is rampant in our nation and in our world. We have taught people that you are your boss. I have nurtured this vineyard. I don't care who the owner is. I want now to have the grapes for myself. So part of what we do when we listen to stories like this is we go, well, that makes perfect sense. This story makes sense that the owner should come back and punish these evil workers that did not honor the contract. So we can listen to the story and understand it in our minds, but we can't understand that the story is really about us. That God comes to us and says, what have you done with this body, your vineyard, which I gave you? And we say, oh, I forgot you gave it to me. I thought it was my vineyard. I thought it was my grapes. I thought I could take the harvest myself, right? So it's this tug of war we have with God, where God needs to be the one who owns, possesses, and God is the one who made us, brought us into this world for a purpose, for a reason. And so we so often, our act of worship is to once again remember that God gave us all of these good gifts for his grace, for his service, that we are to become a sanctuary, a living sacrifice for Christ. It is our task to give of ourselves. I was in conversation with someone recently who said, I know it is our job to give of ourselves in Christ, but I don't want to give too much. I just want to give so much. And that's good. Better to give so much than not give at all. But better to recognize that when we align ourselves with Christ and give what we have to Christ, he can do so much with us. And to recognize that when we try to deny that Christ is the owner of this wonderful vineyard, that we have so much potential, that Christ is asking us, please be the good servants, harvest these grapes so that we can have a bountiful produce for everyone. So as we think about today and we think about the importance of who we are as a people, as part of this world family of churches, it's World Communion Sunday. And we think to ourselves so often about how divided we can be as churches and as people of faith, even just in our nation and throughout our world. Much of that happens because we think of ourselves as having the ability to make choices, a lot of choices, about who we are and what we are as Christians, instead of looking to Christ, who is over all of us, and humbly allowing Christ to be the Lord of our lives, and therefore aligning ourselves as brothers and sisters throughout this world. Imagine how the world could be changed if we truly came to the communion table, welcomed everyone to that table, humbled ourselves before the Lord, recognized that he owns us and that we are his possession and not our own, and then worked together as a team to change this world. That's the vision of this Sunday, and that's the vision of World Communion Sunday. And that's also the vision of this simple song that we've sung so many times, Lord, prepare me to be this beautiful sanctuary. So as we commune now together, I hope that everyone gathered in our sanctuary and those of you online will take a minute to get your bread and get your cup and to come to this table where there's room for everyone. Let us commune together. Dear Lord, as we come to this table, we do break bread together on our knees in humility, recognizing that you are the host of this table. It is not ours, Lord. We come to your table. We gather, allowing you to be the Lord of our lives, guiding and directing us. And Lord, it's also with humility that we recognize that this is a table not only where there's room for everyone, but there's also the recognition that almost everyone at this table, except for Christ himself, is broken, and we need this table desperately, Lord. So allow this table to transform us and to bring us together, and we humbly, Lord, submit to this moment of communion with you. Amen. Would you share with me these sacred words of institution? For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and blessed it and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Would you pray with me? Lord, as we hold this cup, it is a common cup of all people throughout our world. We all, Lord, need nourishment, and we all need water, and we all need to have those things every single day. So this is our daily cup. And Lord, we ask that as we hold this in our hands, we can appreciate the value of it, the cost of it, and also that it represents the brokenness of Christ, who literally gave himself for us. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name. And again, these words from the Bible. In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Sometimes when we have conversations about who is the Lord of our life, we can say, "Yes, Lord, yes, I'll give you my time. I will give you my devotion. I will give you an hour on Sundays. But don't ask me to give money. I'm not going to do that. I only have so much of that to give, and I'm worried about my finances." But so often that's what Jesus puts on the number one of his list, that I need you to give your money because, number one, it's really important. It helps us to do the Lord's work. And number two, it's about that idea of stewardship, that it's my money. It's the Lord's money. I just want my money so that I can do my work. So our offering is a way that we show and remind ourselves of our alignment with Christ and his purposes. So let us give freely.
God, from whom all blessings flow, praise him, all creatures here below, praise him above the heavenly hosts, praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
As we close with our closing hymn, it is an opportunity for us to remind ourselves of our devotion to Christ and to align ourselves with him. And so let us join together in our closing hymn.
Pass it on.
It only takes a spark to get those around can warm up in its glowing. That's how it is with God's love. Once you've experienced it, you spread his love to everyone. You want to pass it on. I wish for you, my friend, this happiness that I found. You can depend on Him. It matters not where you're bound. I'll shout it from the mountaintop. I want my world to know the Lord of love has come.
Dear Lord, you know, today's message is challenging because it is really strange to remind ourselves over and over that you made us, that we were brought from this divine spirit into the world for a purpose. Lord, so often the concept of who you are in our lives can get muddled with the message we receive from this world, that we are our own makers, that we design our own lives. So, Lord, we pray for humility. We pray for direction. We pray for realignment. We pray for the ability to recognize that you are the Lord of our lives and to give you the control. Lord Jesus, take the wheel and drive us forward, Lord, into the future. Lord, we want to ask special prayers for our nation. We are in a time of concern. Our president is hospitalized. And so we pray, Lord, for his health and for the health of other important cabinet members who are also have also contracted COVID-19. So special prayers, Lord, during this time for our nation, Lord. Special prayers, Lord, for our nation also in this time as we come into our election cycle and for the smooth transition of power, Lord, and just however that happens, so for guidance and direction and support for our leaders and our nation. For, Lord, our world, as we continue to find ourselves under the strains and concerns of this worldwide pandemic. Lord, also words of concern for individuals in our church family. We have individuals facing medical concerns. We have individuals that are worried about financial concerns. We have individuals that have prayers and concerns about their families and how families are flexing and moving through this time of pandemic and quarantine and schools being different than they were previously last year. So, special prayers, Lord, for our families during this time. Lord, also prayers that we could remind ourselves on this special Sunday morning of our devotion to Christ, our ability to allow him be the Lord of our lives. So, Lord, we ask that you remind us of that and you allow us to be truly called your disciples. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
We close with the Spirit song.
Oh, let the Son of God enfold you with His Spirit and His love. Let Him fill your heart and satisfy your soul.